Hi, hello. Welcome to our lesson on visual effects and post-production. Today we are going to talk about this concept of mini-narratives, which is basically what you are expected to do as final production in this module. So let's see what these mini-narratives are and how they relate to bigger narratives. We will talk about the concept of narrative versus narrativity. We'll talk about also visual identity, logos, typographies, colors, and how these interact in order to provide more information about this narrative that we are referencing. In the laboratory, we are going to start conceptualizing our project. We expect you to have a clear idea or some kind of working idea during this first week. You are expected to have a title by the end of the week and a working title for your project, although you might change that later, but it is very, very advisable to stick to a concept or a title or idea. Okay. We also recommend the other coordinator and I to refresh your knowledge in After Effects and Unreal. Game students might be interested in working with Unreal and the possibilities of cinematography within this virtual environment. Other students might prefer to stick to the After Effects in order to create your cut scene or your opening or your ending scene. So that's up to you. So you might remember this slide. We have talked about this concept before. Narrative is not only a story. A narrative refers to the elements that make us to recognize something as a story. So narrative is when someone wants something, but there are obstacles on the way. You have heard about this before. But remember that when we define the subject of our story, this someone could be many things. Who? It could be many people. It could be many information, so much information that we deliver or not, or we hide about this person, or this animal, or this creature, or whatever. To want something, it is also very open. Exactly, it's what we call in narratology the narrative program. It is the objective of the person or the subject during the narration. And there is always an opposition between narrative programs. For example, in a game like Street Fighter, you might find that one fighter has a program, a narrative program, that is to win the competition, but obviously all the other characters might have the same narrative program. No? So it depends on who you are playing with, the story, but transform, obviously. So the obstacles on the way can be defined also in many, many different ways, okay? But basically, these are also necessary to tell a story. Traditionally, we talk about the difference between representing reality, what is called mimesis, or representing a story, which is called diegesis. So this is not really that important. We are storytellers. We are constructing our reality. But there are some concepts that you might remember. Okay. First is the three-act structure. You might have heard about this already. So most of the stories seems to repeat this structure of three acts, where in the first one, you create a setup. You create an introduction to the characters. And at the end of the first act, you usually tell the people, well, this is the character, this is what the character wants. The confrontation, the second act, it's really more a serial structure. So there are different elements of different problems that are connected. The third act, which we call resolution, is marked with a very important and very explicit confrontation that we call climax. okay, which is this second plot. Okay, so usually resolution is shorter than the second act. Okay, so if you see here, you see that approximately could be 25%, 50%, and 25%, that if we express that as percentage. Remember, a story and plot are not the same. Okay, the typical example I put, and you can see that here on my slides, is the difference between plot and a story on a crime movie. You go, you see the body, you have to discover yet who did it. But if you go to the story, obviously the story, it is logically presented. Someone kills someone, you know, then the policeman starts the investigation, finally they catch the killer. So the important thing here is that we define and we understand the different terms, okay? Plot, story, the events, specific elements within the story, or the timeline, which is the creation of a logically and chronologically order for these events. Check these openings and endings and let me know what you think about this. Do you think these are related to the narrative or not? To the narrative of the series or the movie they are referring. So now you can have a better idea what I'm talking about. I'm talking about this as well in the discussion. But yeah, if you think about Game of Thrones, there is some relation to the narrative, and probably most of you have seen episodes from Game of Thrones, or you know what this is about. So this creation of the map and this representation of the map, it refers to other narratives on the epic world. If you think about, for example, all the work of Tolkien, Tolkien usually included maps at the beginning of the books. So it is very important for the people in reading fantasy to see, oh, this is a new world. These are new countries. This is a new geographical space. And then everything comes with that. The people from the north are this way. The people from the south are this other way. The people from the west or the east, they want different things. So if you know about the world of Game of Thrones, Westeros is the dominant group of countries, and within them there is particularly a country with the capital in Kingsland or King's Landing, or is it? And it's basically the hegemonic power in this fantasy world. Okay, so creating the map in the opening, it refers to these narratives, refers to the narrative of the book and the idea of the confrontation. And then there are different very good ideas in the opening, and that is why it's really, really a nice piece. And it's this idea of personalizing the order of the different points within the map. And this is related to the narrative of each individual episode. And that level of customization is really, really very interesting. So think about musical videos. And this is another example of this mini narrative. Any of the examples I'm putting here on the links would be good enough to have a discussion as well. Have you checked them already? Well, the thing here is that musical videos can refer as well to different narratives, sometimes very explicitly, like for example this very famous movie or little short film, which is the musical video of Thriller from Michael Jackson. But sometimes it's more difficult to see exactly what kind of story or what kind of concept is behind, you know? And the point here is that sometimes musical videos are not narrative. And you have to talk about that. We see some elements of narrative, but it's not really a narrative in the sense we commented before. Theories of adaptation, like for example, this famous Chemo Chatman concept, talks about kernels and satellites. So sometimes when we talk about big narratives, like for example, franchise or you know, different products that are connected, we talk about satellites, like stories that are not that important, and the kernels. Think about this famous story, the Red Little Riding Hood. Even if you compare the different versions of the story, and I'm talking about different versions because I understand if your mother or your father has told you this story, you might remember some elements of the story. Different thousands of adaptations with the years in TV, video games, comics, and whatever, they have kept the basic elements. There is a girl, there is the red costume, and there is a wolf, okay? And there is a grandma, but then there are other things that might not be that important, okay? Satellites refer to these other narratives, these other elements that might be connected to the kernels, to the elements that are essential for the plot. Are video games narrative? Well, this is something we have commented before, but basically what you find is that some people refer to video games as something like it's purely interactive, and other people recognize that there are elements of representation within video games. So the extreme case would be arcade games that basically are interactive movies, like for example the work of Naughty Dog. All these Last of Us or Uncharted are good examples. But you have others, examples that are pure interactive or very difficult to find a narrative here. Think, for example, in simulations, like, for example, you cannot see that here on the slides, but this snooker game, for example. What exactly is it telling you as a story? So it's difficult to see the narrative here. So this position is represented by what we call radical ludologism. Simulation would be opposed to narrative in that sense, okay? But on the other hand, we will have that all media are using the older media, okay? So, for example, digital media is using movies, it's using comic books, it's using other language that are nested within the digital media language, and that is obviously a proof of this representation. This is what we call remediation, okay? All media have elements of interactivity and immersion. So in that sense, we have elements that are asking the audience to participate. And there are other elements where we are just, you know, involving ourselves in the narration. We are just enjoying and not participating in the narrative, only as listeners, I mean. So think about any kind of media. And you would think TV is not really that interactive. Well, there are examples of that. Think about Dora the Explorer, for example. It's quite interactive in some aspects, okay? Think about the experience of watching a movie in the cinema. You can do interactivity there. It doesn't mean the filmmaker have made a space for your interactivity, as you can find in other examples, like, for example, this Dora the Explorer. But interactivity is a concept that is situated in a continuum, as well as immersion is. Another concept related to narrativity within video games is the cutscenes. Cutscenes are these little movies that we can access during the gameplay. Cutscenes have evolved considerably, as the video games have done. Think about this Gabriel Knight, which was a very narrative game. Kind of supernatural, maybe, if you have ever seen that series from the 2000s. this kind of series with a paranormal element, an investigation. So let's check some of these features within the examples. You can go now and check the links. What about this one? This one is using a real image. This is the second video game of the saga. So at that time, more colors, more power on the computer. So it was kind of a talent, technical talent to do this. Although kind of very old, no? Right now, looks very old. And finally, we get to something very similar to what we have today, using the 3D game engine to simulate these movies. So there is a more smooth transition between the game and the narrative. Okay, so there's exactly the same quality, the same graphics, it's the same game engine. It's just that right now the technology allows a more sophisticated construction of characters, no more polygons and more quality, but it's the same concept. Another kind of cutscene is the QuickTime event. This is very popularized in a franchise like God of War. And you can see here these moments where there is a sequence of different animations, very short animations that are prepared or are triggered by the interaction of the controller. You want to look at a very famous example of this, check Dragon Slayer. Okay, maybe you have seen that. It was on the second season of Stranger Things. Another element of narrativity within video games and other digital narratives, it's the visual identity. Okay, when you think about visual identity, the typography, the colors, or the presentation of a brand, it is exactly the same that happens with the openings and endings of a video game or a TV show. Okay. The idea here is that the visual identity is anticipating some of the emotions and some of the most recognizable features of the narrative world the TV show or the product in general is presenting. It's important to understand the difference between these concepts, identity, image, visual identity. I would recommend some reading about this. But the key aspect here is that there is always two ways of understanding this. One way is what I think I am, that is identity, and what I'm projecting to others, which is image. Okay, so when we talk about a visual image, we are talking about what we project. Okay, but visual identity, usually in the way of handbooks like this one, are more complex. It tells you how you have to behave in relation to the brand or what kind of ideas you want to transmit. But then later that document is shared about other members of the team, communication teams or production team or whatever, and they are using that to create their products. So it is understandable that if you want to create a opening or an ending for a series, you might want to think about what I'm going to reflect, what kind of emotions, what kind of aspects, what kind of elements of my narrative are more important to highlight in the opening. So that way, there should be a coherence, should be some kind of, redundance within the poster, the trailer, the opening, and all this. Okay, and that is exactly the same logic that happens with the umbrella brands within, in marketing. Okay, imagine, for example, all the video games of the same franchise getting the same style. Okay, same kind of covers, same kind of typography, same kind of, rendering, for example, in the game engine. But also, you have to think about standardization, accessibility, how make the things readable, how make the things more indexable on systems. So obviously, there are also elements of standardization that are common in visual identity. Think about the franchise, as I say. Logo, it's quite important. Transmit the feeling of what is to play a game or what is to see a TV show or whatever. Maybe not everything can be a good example, although it's not easy to find bad examples on the internet. Usually we try to link to our portfolio only the good products, but sometimes there are some products that doesn't feel like good examples of visual identity. Create a good brand recognition is positive if in the sense that contributes to image recognition, okay, to the brand recognition of, and also contributes implicitly to a positive attitude towards the brand. Okay, think about the different typographies, okay? Make your typographies, your fonts accessible, transferable to other languages. Okay, all these things are important. It is the same with the naming. If you create a product, you usually try to create namings that are not, for example, involving a different meaning in another language. At least in the most important languages, the languages more spoken through the world. You wouldn't create, for example, a name for a series that is, involving a bad word in another language. Today we have frame openings, endings, and cutscenes as all these examples of mini narratives. Okay, we have discussed also visual identity. And how typographies, fonts, colors, style is setting up the properties of audiovisual product. So I think this could be good information to reflect and to work towards our projects. That's all. Thank you very much and see you around.